Researching your background, Les, I read that there was one tune that had a very great effect on you as a very young boy. It was called That's a Plenty, here played by Tommy Dorsey, and not the version by his brother Jimmy that you heard as a young boy. Did your passion for the big bands lead you to the large orchestral pieces that you have also had so much success with?
Yeah, that was a rather fascinating story because I was a young boy and my father took me to a wedding, or I think it was a wedding, yeah. And when we went in, this music was playing, albeit by the Jimmy Dorsey Orchestra. And I don't know, I just stood still. I thought, God, that's wonderful. And of course, it was Dixieland music, and it really brought something out in my soul. So I thought, how can all those instruments be playing together with, you know, and playing the right notes? Of course, as a youngster, I didn't realise that it was the arrangers that put them all together, and then they played his arrangement, which I was to become. So really, it had such an effect on me, that particular record. And it remained with me forever. And in the early days, I used to use, not use, but I had this kind of psychic mind where I used to put my favourites up on my bedroom wall. And every one of those that were up there, there was Sinatra, there was Sammy Davis, there were the Dorsey brothers, Benny Goodman, all of those wonderful people from the States, up in my bedroom on my wall. And the strange thing is that I ended up getting to know, as friends, most of them, all of them, in fact, and working with people like Sammy and writing a song for Sinatra. Dean Martin recorded our songs. I got very friendly with Jerry Lewis. We made a film together called One More Time. Peter Lawford. All of these guys became incredibly good friends over the years. And I don't know whether it's fate or whether it's some kind of attraction to their talent, but Jimmy was absolutely wonderful, Jimmy Dorsey. And of course, I met Tommy with the Count Basie Orchestra in New York, and we had lunch together. And Basie kept looking at me. He said, "Did you really write Delilah?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Well, you look too young." And I said, "Well, you know, can you explain that?" He said, "Well, I was playing that song in 1920. And I looked at him, I said, "No, you couldn't have done." He said, "Well, there's only one famous Delilah." He said, "That's the jazz classic." And of course, there was another Delilah written in 1917, I believe, called Delilah. And so we had a laugh about it. And my manager at the time said, "No, Les wrote this other one in 1965. So it wasn't the same one, but it is a very, very big hit." And he got a wee bit embarrassed, and I got a call from him about 2 days later. He said, "I just heard this guy Jones singing Delilah." He said, "It's fantastic, you know." And it was such a lovely moment for me. So Jimmy Dorsey really was the start of my getting into big band music. So from then on, it just developed. And that's where I went. I used the big orchestras and big bands ever since. So good on you, Jimmy.
From big band and orchestral music into musicals themselves, this style of music has not evaded you either.
No, I've always wanted to do a musical, a stage musical. And it started very early with Gorton and Simpson, two famous writers here, who called up one day and said, "Les, we've just written this story about a subject called Beware Au Pair. We wondered if you'd like to write the music." So Jackie Ray, my lyricist at the time, and I went to see Gorton and Simpson. And it was the funniest meeting ever because, yes, I'd already sort of Beware Au Pair. I'd already prepared a melody for them, which they liked very much. And they said, "Well, you know, while you're here, let's work out some ideas." And both of them just laid on the floor and went to sleep. And I couldn't understand that. It seemed as if they were asleep. But what they did, because they were so close psychically, they used to use telepathy. And on the floor, they would sort of exchange ideas telepathically. Sorry about that. And Jackie and I just sat there wondering what was happening next, and they both jumped up and said, "This is it. This is what we're going to do." And they told us the story from top to finish. And it was incredible. But we couldn't get backing for it. And then a few years later, I was involved with American Heroes, which is Barry Mason came up and wrote this show. And I had three or four songs in that. That was lovely. And it got one sort of showing in the West End. But again, no interest money-wise. And then I wrote a musical with Ben Nisbet called And Then I Wrote, which was renamed Tin Pan Alley. And that went into Sonning for about 8 weeks, a little theatre in Sonning in Berkshire, to great success. And we had lovely actors like Craig Douglas, the old singer, played the main character. John Judd, which is Helen Shapiro's husband, and a couple of Shakespeare actors. And it was very successful. And in fact, the Americans wanted to take it to Vegas, but because it was a mill, they wanted to take the mill as well to Vegas. They wanted to uproot the whole theatre and take it to Vegas. And of course, they were refused. But so it never evolved in America. And then the next one was That Woman, written with Eddie Seeger, which was about Wallis Simpson, and to this day is still being considered by people in the business, not least of all the old Vic, which is now being run by Kevin Spacey. And then recently I did Beautiful and Damned with Roger Cook, Story of Zelda and Scott Fitzgerald, which ended up in the West End at the Lyric Theatre for 16 weeks. And we had some wonderful reviews on that. Some not so very good, but that's what happened with musicals. Now it's being considered for Canada, so we're keeping fingers crossed. Outside of that, two or three little others, which are not worth mentioning. You know, the hardest thing, Mike, is to be able to get people to back these shows, because you're in for maybe £5 or £6 million to be able to launch shows, and there just is not that money around these days. So we're keeping fingers crossed anyway. One of my biggest joys was to work with Sir Terence Rattigan on a show called Trilby, which we started together, along with Peter Hart, who was a wonderful lyricist. We got halfway through the show, and Sir Terence died. So we just pulled the plug on the whole show, but it is a beautiful story. I might reinvent it one day, because it really does tell a wonderful story. And, of course, it would be in the memory of Sir Terence. So let's keep fingers crossed.
On to the classics now. Now, here I must ask you about one particular recording that does give me very damp eyes. Your version of Elgar's Nimrod, that is associated very much, of course, with Remembrance Day. Was it your and your father's time in the army that led you to record this piece of music? Not forgetting, of course, your beautiful Lest We Forget.
Sir Edward Elgar was always one of my favourite British composers. In fact, Sir Arthur Bliss, I and a few other people, conductors, did a special concert at the Albert Hall many years ago, which included my own version of Elgar's Nimrod. And also I did the Beetlecracker Suite, which was a classical piece based on all of the Beatles songs, which was absolutely lovely. And I always remember Sir Arthur Bliss saying at the end of the concert, "I really enjoyed your Nimrod. I've never heard it so differently played." because I'd changed the original Elgar arrangement to suit my own needs, basically. But he did like it, and it was a lovely concert. We raised a lot for charity that night with the London Symphony Orchestra. It was absolutely wonderful. But yes, ever since I was a boy, Sir Edward Elgar has really meant a lot to me. And rather like Gustav Holst and his music, they've been inherent. basically in my mind for many, many years. And I decided that one day I would record that version on record, and it has turned out to be a favourite amongst people. Even though when I recorded it at Wessex Studios all those years ago, the musicians, especially the string players, raised their eyes a little because they'd been so used to playing the original Elgar arrangement. But they liked it, so I got away with that one. As far as Lest We Forget is concerned, I was in Denmark and we did a tattoo for King Frederick, because he was Air Colonel in Chief of the Buffs Regiment, the Royal East Kents. And I shall never, ever forget the trumpet players playing against Auld Lang Syne. And it was absolutely magical. And I decided then, even as an 18-year-old, that I would record this piece one day with my own orchestra, intertwining the Last Post with some beautiful melodies behind it. And it's turned out very, very well. In fact, the YouTube version of it is so popular. And it's being requested all over the globe. So I was very pleased to get that one out. Yeah, but both Sir Edward and Gustav Holst have been a great inspiration to me over the years.
What to the future? What unfulfilled ambition does Les Reed still have lurking away that we can expect to see successfully completed over the next few years?
Oh, my ambitions. Every day I think about something new. What can we do to raise, you know, hopes of the people through music? But right recently I decided to write a little piece called The Olympus Suite in Three Movements. Now, I have to tell you that in the last year or so, I've just been concentrating basically on classical music, completing the Niagara Suite for Tommy Riley, the wonderful harmonica player who recorded it with the Stuttgart Symphony Orchestra and another orchestra as well. He's done a wonderful recording on it. My Jubilation Suite, the Grand National Anthem, and indeed this Erin Symphony, which I am just about to finish. So I have that and this new Olympus Suite, which is being put out on record, along with a little quirky little record called Go Mo Go, which I wrote in respect of Mo Farah, the Olympic runner. So everybody's aware of it. There's a great YouTube on it. And we're hoping that all the people will pick it up and chant along this song when Mo is running in the Olympics. but apart from that, I think my ambition really is to keep the music flowing and keep people happy, because for the last 50 or even more now, 55 years, music has been the only thing I really know about.
And now to close, Les, the most difficult question of all. I'm going to ask you to pick just one piece of music to play you out. It's a bit like a family being asked to choose their favourite child, I know, but I ask it nevertheless.
Well, Mike, that's a hard one. I would like to be able to pick some of my favourite records of all time of other people's songs. But in respect of them, and in retrospect, I suppose this is about me, so I guess I ought to pick one of my own songs. One, do you remember the pictures on the wall in my bedroom with all those stars that I finally met? Well, there was another one called Bing Crosby. And we met, and we presented him, Peter Hart and I presented him with a song called That's What Life Is All About. He loved it, absolutely adored it. We saw him at the Palladium. He said, but the lyric is not appertaining to me personally. So we both said, well, why don't you change it? So he changed the lyric and he recorded the song just about, I don't know, about a year later. And he was getting towards the end of his life and he was on the golf course. And this was after the song had been released and it was a big hit in this country. And he died on the golf course. So I don't suppose he ever saw the result of that recording. It was his very last hit. And to us, it was a tragedy. But on the other hand, we had that memory of Bing and being able to be at least part of his career, albeit at the end of his life. So I would love you to play As a Memory for Me. That's What Life is All About by Bing Crosby. Thank you.
My life is like an open book, and as I glance back through the pages, I see the chances I often took, though I was never too courageous. Life's never easy all the time. The hills you climb often lead nowhere. Of ups and downs, I've had my share. That's what life is all about. I've known success, some mild acclaim, and thinking of it gives me pleasure. And I've had some stress, the scars remain when Lady Luck gave me short measure. When things went wrong, I'd fake a smile, but that's my style, 'cause I've been around. And having been around, I've found that's what life is all about. It's been a joy, I can't deny, though some may think I took things lightly. But man and boy, I looked on high and never failed to thank him nightly. When I look back, I can't forget the friends I've met and the things they've done. I thank them all. It's been great fun. As for me, I have no doubt. That's what life is all about. That's what life is all about.
Thank you so very much for taking your valuable time to speak with me today and all our listeners here on Curtain Radio in Perth, Western Australia. But most of all, thank you for the musical pleasure that you have given to so many people over the last 50 years. For that, we are so very grateful.
Mike, it's been my pleasure, and I send my love, best wishes to everybody in Australia. Thank you.
Before we go, I did ask Les Reed what the secret of his success was. And he answered in this particular way. He said he didn't write for musicians, although he loves them dearly, or for critics, or for self-opinionated songwriters. He said he wrote for people in the street and your everyday Joe, who all have a passion for music and song. He said that in his 50 years or so, he had made a lifelong study to explore over that time what touches people's emotions. And he said it came down to simplistic and beautiful melodies, enhanced by melodic orchestration. He said that those bits, along with meaningful and sometimes sad lyrics, held the key to success in the general public psyche. In other words, he said, you reach their innermost thoughts and emotions. He added that his philosophy was never to dwell on his success, but to move on to the next job in hand. Ladies, gentlemen, the music of Les Reed.
I wonder, should I go or should I stay? The band had only one more song to play. And then I saw you at the corner of my eye. A little girl alone and so shy. I had the last waltz with you. Was going strong. Through the good and bad we get along. And then the flame of love died in your eyes. My heart was broken too when you said goodbye. I had the last waltz with you. Tears and the orchestra play. La 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 la. I had the last waltz with you. La 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 la.